Welcome to this lecture about combustion boilers, stoves and furnaces for space and hot tap water heating. This is the second of the heating systems we want to look at. We already studied the combustion equation, lower and higher heating values and CO2 emissions related to combustion, so you already know a lot. Let's look first at the different types of combustion boilers and stoves. Note that stoves and furnaces are synonymous. We will consider two main types of combustion devices, fireplaces and stoves, and central heating boilers. Let's start with fireplaces and stoves. They are used for direct space heating at room level. Simple fireplaces, like the one on the picture, have a very low efficiency, less than 0.2 in general. Most heat is released with the exhaust gases through the chimney to the outdoor. Additionally, combustion gases, smoke and particulate matter may enter the room and result in a poor indoor air quality. However, they use biomass and are often experienced as being pleasant and cozy. That's why many improvements have been realized, like the use of inserts, like on this picture. An insert is a casing of steel or iron and insulating glass, which prevents the heat to flow away. Some of these systems are equipped with a fan that blows the heat into the room and sometimes even through other rooms by having the pipe with exhaust gas led through these rooms. As for the efficiency, it will be around 0.4 to 0.6 depending on the model. Be aware that the air needed for combustion is taken from the room itself, meaning that the room needs to be well ventilated to ensure a good indoor quality. Next to these wood stoves, there are also coal and gas stoves. Coal and gas stoves may look like this, or look more similar to wood inserts. Generally, they are placed in the room away from the walls, by which a larger part of the heat produced finally ends into the room by convection or radiation. Such gas and coal stoves may have an efficiency between 60 and 85%. Just like for the wood stoves, air is taken from the room by which good ventilation is needed. There are also systems with an extra pipe in such a way that air is taken from outdoor. In all cases, special attention should be paid to emissions of carbon monoxide, which is an extremely lethal gas arising from incomplete combustion. This is even more worse with coal, for which incomplete combustion is more likely to happen and which also emits a lot of particulate matter damageable for human health. CO sensors should be placed anyways. The second type are the so-called boilers. They may be used for hot tap water or for space heating. For space heating, they can deliver warm water to room radiators in a closed loop where the colder water at the end of the radiator flows back to the boiler to be heated again. Instead of radiators, warm water can also be delivered to a heat exchanger heating the ventilation air if mechanical ventilation is applied. There is then an air handling unit. There are also some small instant open gas boilers to heat hot tap water. They are placed close to the tap, just like the electrical instant boilers. We are not going to handle them as they are going to be phased out in many countries because of their intrinsic health hazards regarding carbon monoxide emissions. Sometimes hot tap water and space heating boilers are combined together, the so-called combi boilers. There are also steam boilers that are used to produce steam to generate electricity in power plants. The last category are the boilers used to generate steam in the humidification process of air in air handling units, which will be studied in the MOOC Efficient HVAC Systems. Boilers may be found in all sizes, from small ones for home heating to large ones for heating of a wall apartment block to even larger ones in district heating systems and power plants. They can be based on biomass like wood pellets, coal, oil, gas, or even hydrogen. Just like for electrical boilers, there may be instant boilers or boilers with tanks. Because of the high CO2 content of coal, of coal boilers and the diverse emissions of particulate matter and harmful combustion products producing, for instance, smog, their use is decreasing, especially their direct use in buildings. However, in many countries like the Netherlands, they are still used for power generation, and in other countries like China for large district heating systems. Hydrogen boilers are a new development. When burning hydrogen with oxygen from air, the only combustion product is water. There is therefore no production of CO2, except for the making of hydrogen itself. Let's study on the example of a gas boiler how condensing, non-condensing and combi boilers work. It would work the same with other fuels, although the internal design will be different. I remind you that the boiler is providing warm water to either radiators or a heat exchanger. In these pictures, the gas supply to the burner is not shown. Let's start with the picture of a non-condensing boiler. The air needed for combustion is supplied by a pipe, the white one, and goes to the burner. In the burner, the gas is burned and the fumes and flames give their heat to the cold return water from the radiators through a heat exchanger. The heated water flows to the radiator. There is a fan above expelling the fumes and combustion products like CO2 and CO to the outside through a pipe. As you may remind from a former lecture, these exhaust gases may have a temperature up to 150 degrees Celsius, although it is generally lower because the heat exchanger cools them down. In a condensing boiler, an additional heat exchanger is placed. See here on the left of the burner, and the fumes, which contain a lot of water vapor, are now directed to this heat exchanger, where they give their heat to the cold return water before flowing outside through the exhaust pipe. Not only the fumes gives heat back, also and mainly the water vapor contained in the fumes. This water vapor contains a lot of latent energy that is released when the vapor is cooled down enough to condensate. Of course, these droplets of condensed water must be drained out of the boiler through an additional pipe. So, with this condensation, much more heat is recovered from the burning process. You may remember that we defined the higher heating value as being obtained by cooling the fumes down to 25 degrees Celsius. Well, such a low temperature will seldom be achieved in the boiler because the cold return water from the radiator has generally a temperature between 45 and 70 degrees. Only in so-called low-temperature systems like floor heating or air heating in an air handling unit, the return temperature may be lower, down to 30 degrees. Because of these temperatures higher than 25, the efficiency of the boiler will never be 1 and will depend on the return temperature. A combi boiler may be found in condensing and non-condensing designs. The principle here is that an additional heat exchanger is placed for hot tap water heating. When there is a demand for hot tap water, the hot water flow to the radiator is diverted to the water-to-water heat exchanger below, where it gives its heat to the cold tap water referred as CW in the drawing, which is heated this way, CHW in the drawing. Because the demand for hot tap water is generally for a short time, like a few seconds at the kitchen tap to 15 minutes in a shower, people won't notice that the space heating has stopped. We have discussed the effect of the temperature of the return water on the efficiency of the heat recovery from the exhaust gases in condensing boilers. The uptake of heat by the radiator water in the boiler depends on the temperature difference between the return and the hot water. Q is mass flow rate of water times specific heat times temperature difference. A boiler with a certain nominal power is designed to ensure a specific temperature difference, for instance 20 degrees. And that may be achieved by having a hot temperature of 90 and a return of 70, or by having a hot temperature of 80 and a return of 60, or even by having 60-40. We call the range 9070 high temperature radiators, while the range below 7050 is called low temperature radiators. A side thought, be aware that low temperature radiators need to be larger than high temperature radiators to transfer the same quantity of heat to the room. But nevertheless, the figure on the left shows the general trend in efficiency as function of the return water temperature. If you look at the right part, above 55 degrees, you see that regardless of the return temperature, the efficiency is quite constant and remains between 0.84 and 0.86. On the left part of the graphic, you see the condensing mode and huge efficiency variations depending on the return temperature. The condensing mode takes place only when the return water temperature is below 55 degrees Celsius. This is because under the current fume composition, pressure and temperature, the water vapor can condensate only below 55 degrees. This is called the dew point temperature of the fumes. This means that if you buy a condensing boiler and your return temperature is above 55 degrees, the boiler will never work in condensing mode. It is therefore of utmost importance to use low return temperatures. Now that we have studied the effect of condensation on the efficiency, let's look at the other heat losses. Just like with electrical boilers, if tanks are used to store hot water, the total efficiency of the system will decrease because of the heat losses in the tank by radiation and convection. In the boiler itself, heat losses take place mainly through the flue gases, which is the name of the exhaust fumes and gases. These losses are also sometimes called stack losses and can be reduced by applying heat recovery from the fumes and water vapor, like in a condensing boiler. There may be also losses through moisture in the combustion air and moisture in the fuel itself, especially with biomass. Part of the combustion heat is then used to evaporate this moisture. Additional losses will take place in solid fuels like coal and biomass when there is unburned fuel in the ashes and in the fly ash. The fly ash is the ash flowing away with the exhaust fumes. The ash deposits in the combustion chamber may also cause problems if they are not removed timely. And of course, there are radiation and convection losses through the boiler casing. And finally, we should not forget the so-called standby losses. When no heat is needed, the boiler switches on the standby mode in which the burner periodically starts heating the few liters of water it contains in the heat exchanger and the pipes. These standby losses generally amount 1 or 2% of the total energy use. In addition, we should not forget some electricity is used as well for the electronics in the control system, for the fans in the boiler, and for the circulation pump for the radiator water. This electricity use is around 100 to 500 kilowatt hour yearly for domestic boilers, depending on the brand and production year. It is not accounted for in the efficiency. Finally, it is interesting to look at the efficiency curves of boilers when they are not working full load, but in partial load. You may remember that the nominal load should meet the highest heating demand over a year. Generally, especially in moderate climates, this nominal load occurs only during a limited number of hours, and the boiler will be working in partial load most of the time. See here this picture of the heat demand of a building over 1 year, where it is clear that the boiler will have to work almost all time in partial load. Happily enough, you can see on this figure, the efficiency of boilers is quite constant and independent on their load, as long as the load is higher than 25%. At lower loads, the efficiency starts to decrease. We will work with an average efficiency all over the heating season, the so-called seasonal efficiency. No matter which fuel is used, the seasonal efficiencies vary between the same limits, but be aware they vary depending on brand, quality of the model and purity of fuel. Note also that most modern boilers are condensing ones, at least if the return temperature is suitable. Concerning boilers for hot tap water, condensation boilers are generally not applicable as the temperature should be kept above 60 degrees Celsius to avoid the growth of the Legionella bacteria, which is harmful for human health. However, such a temperature is needed only once a week, by which it is possible to lower the temperature to 50 degrees and therefore to profit a little bit from the condensation heat. Let's take the example of a building with a yearly heating demand of 3000 kWh. This heat is produced by a non-condensing gas boiler with efficiency 0.7. The needed energy input is therefore 3000 divided by 0.7, which is 4286 kWh. Gas is a primary resource. Therefore, we can say that the primary energy consumption is 4286 kWh. We know that the energy content of gas is 35.2 megajoules per cubic meter, which is the same as 9.8 kilowatt hour per cubic meter. With this, we can easily calculate the needed volume of gas, which is 4286 divided by 9.8 equals 437 cubic meter that will be depleted. And what about the CO2 emissions? We know that the CO2 emissions of natural gas are 0.2 kg CO2 equivalent per kilowatt hour primary energy. The CO2 emissions are therefore 4286 times 0.2 equals 857 kg CO2. Maybe you remember that in case of electrical heating we found 1500 kg CO2. The gas boilers will therefore emit only 57% of the CO2 emissions of an electrical boiler. In this lecture, you have learned how heat production by fuel combustion works. We handled first systems working at room level, like fireplaces and stoves. We studied then central heating boilers and how they are connected to the hot and cold water from radiators or air handling units. We know now about the principle of condensing boilers and the relationship between their efficiency and the temperature of the return water. You are aware of the different heat losses in a boiler and the influence of the fuels on these losses. You know that partial load has only a limited effect on the seasonal efficiency of boilers, and you have an idea about the efficiency range for different fuels and boiler types. Finally, we handled the case of a non-condensing boiler of efficiency 0.7 and discovered that its CO2 equivalent emissions were 57% lower than the ones of an electrical boiler powered by the Dutch electricity grid. Thank you for your attention.